I run MyCrypto. Previously, I was with my Ether wallet. And so we are a interface for interacting with the Ethereum blockchain. Primary way to, you know, store your funds, send transactions. We have ENS integration, we have contract integration, and all sorts of really, really fun stuff.
Awesome. So when did you join the crypto space? You know, what caught your attention at that time, you know?
It was about, I think, 2013, and it was right before the whole Mt. Gox situation. Oh, okay. And it was just a very, it was an exciting time. And that's when I was really kind of learning about all of this stuff. And, you know, I think I often describe it as like falling down the rabbit hole. And that was definitely my experience, was I was so intrigued, and the limitless possibilities, and your imagination kind of takes off. Yeah. Obviously, like when Mt. Gox happened, it was a bit painful, and it was definitely like a learning experience, I think, for everyone. And then when Vitalik's white paper started being passed around about Ethereum, I was just so intrigued, and I found that Ethereum specifically seemed like the next logical step from Bitcoin.
Yeah,
and so, you know, I was just... You know, in the post-Mt. Gox time, it was just a little bit more depressed. Yeah. And that Ethereum community, the developers, the, you know, Vitalik himself, the white paper, sort of like re-stimulated that imagination. Yeah. And what was possible.
Yeah, totally agree on that. It's like, it's the next logical step, basically. It's, you know, beyond the payments only, it's like, you know, sky's the limit with the ideas and all the stuff on Ethereum. It's totally cool.
Exactly.
So, you know, I myself are a developer. I saw your like beta MyCrypto page. I follow your GitHub. I see like, you know, a lot of changes in the code base and all that stuff. So I see like your team is really strong on that. You know, what's the next features, the next things you're planning in to bring it in, you know, into the wallet?
So for the past like about 7 or 8 months, we've been really just like rewriting the code base. Awesome. In this really modular, it's all written in React and TypeScript. The whole team is been building it. And it's a very different environment from how we were building my Ether wallet, because when we were building my Ether wallet, it was very short term, it was very reactionary. Mm-hmm. And with my crypto from the beginning, we've really set out to with a long-term vision. And that really starts with like having a team of people working together and collaborating together. Obviously, like everything we do is open source, so we have a lot of feedback from the community on both the code level and then the UI level. So from here, you know, the features that we're working on is making the interface and the interaction with the blockchain even more seamless and more easy, and hopefully enabling newer users to the space to really be able to maybe actually safely store their funds, safely control their keys, so that we don't have like another Mt. Gox situation.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, and then specifically, you know, we're working with you guys to do the alarm clock and you know, sending transactions at specific times, and that's really, really exciting for us. And working with other people in this space is really, really exciting for us.
Yeah,
as well.
Awesome. So you know, we had ChronoLogic working with Piper Miriam from Foundation on Ethereum Alarm Clock. Mm-hmm. It's basically a scheduling of transactions on an Ethereum network. So could you tell us, you know, what do you think, how this could basically change the way we kind of working with Ethereum? Because that's kind of something new and basic that everyone probably assumed that, yeah, it should be there. Why it's not there? What's going on? It's like a basic stuff. So
right. And that's exactly what a lot of the blockchain, there are these sort of missing core pieces that, especially when you come from, you know, like online banking and centralized banks in the traditional world, you really... when you enter the blockchain space, you assume that you can do things, and then you're like, oh wait, that's much harder than we thought to do this in a safe and decentralized manner. So specifically with delayed transactions and the alarm clock, it's like, I think it just opens up the possibility for a lot of things. And one of them is with multi-step transactions. So when you have to complete a step and then you wait for something to happen, whether that's something in the real world or just like with the ENS, for example, you're going to initially place that bid, then you're going to have to come back and finalize your bid. You're going to have to come back and reveal your bid, and then you're going to have to come back and finalize it, and then resolve it to an address. These are four steps. Nobody actually really wants to do that.
Yes, you know? It is a hassle, you know, especially when this kind of happen at a time that you, whatever, you sleep or you out of, you know, you can't access your computer, mm-hmm. something like that. Yeah, that's super useful. I totally agree on that.
Yeah, and I mean, us personally, like our team has had a number of times where maybe we're testing something, maybe we want a new domain name, and we always forget to reveal, and then you're like, okay, let's bid again, okay. And so just having the ability to do this really in a decentralized manner, like that's the most important thing for us, because obviously we could build a centralized service, obviously we could do things for the user, but it opens up a lot more risks, and the whole nature of the blockchain is to be decentralized. That's the purpose. And so we're really, really looking forward to this integration.
Yeah, awesome. So we're looking forward to that as well. So hopefully we are going to together bring that to the community soon. That's super nice. So I have kind of other question. I was recently reading your blog post on the future, which is going to be like walletless. I really enjoy that. I mean, I totally grasp the idea, because like today, you know, blockchain, whatever it is, payment or interactions are really like, you know, really hard for like regular people to understand. It's like, why I can't have like, you know, credit card and just blip it and just payments done. So yeah, I totally agree. So could you like talk your thoughts again a little bit about that? So
yeah, I've spent so long building a wallet and now I'm like, this is not the ideal way. And I think that my experience in the space building this wallet is the thing that like pushed me down this path to realize that for your really average user, for my mother, like my mother doesn't use our product. And that's a problem if we're talking about mass adoption. And so the way that I sort of see it moving forward is that the wallet interface as this standalone product, as it is right now, really needs to go away in order to facilitate all sorts of things. And so we're looking for, you know, the things in the next few years that we're looking to do is how do we transition from being just a wallet interface to being something that's a seamless way to interact with the blockchain on a more global level, and especially with dApps.
Yeah, so, totally agree. Like having like a token economy, millions, you know, of different tokens. Who is going to manage that? I mean, how can we do that? Like it's literally impossible to kind of, you know, deal with it.
Right, exactly. And, you know, if we're talking about mass global adoption and we're talking about getting everyone on the blockchain and replacing some of these, you know, broken and inefficient and centralized things, we can't have this like really just upfront like level of confusion. You know, we want to provide a way for people to safely interact with the blockchain where they are in control of their funds, they are in control of their keys, so they don't have to rely on that centralized provider, but also that they can actually do that. Because right now we're seeing so many people, they'll lose their private keys, they don't understand what it is. You know, and then little things like just like, you know, the problems that you guys are solving is they don't understand like, oh, why can't I schedule a transaction? They're so used to that with mobile banking. Why can't I choose to pay this bill in the future? Those types of things. It's, you know, getting from where we are today to getting to the point where we are actually a competitor with the current services that rely on the centralized banks and rely on all of these centralized providers. That's going to be the challenge in the next coming years.
Yeah, I totally agree. I feel also like we're working on such a basic things just to kind of even, you know, what's already in like a centralized world for, you know, years. Mm-hmm. And we kind of playing with the small, tiny stuff just to make it happen. So
yeah,
it was, you know, Taylor, thank you. It was awesome talking to you. It's like
you really, as well. I'm really so great. Glad that we got to catch up.
Yeah, super cool.